library board will come before him. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now we have enough of us to conduct our business. So we'll just affirm that with a roll call. Our able secretary.
Javitt here. Dawson is absent, excuse. Hughes Groves. Jerika.
Here.
Peters.
Here.
Stuber.
Here.
So we are able to convene a quorum present. I will entertain a motion for approval of the agenda.
So moved.
It has been moved by Jerika and supported by Stonemeyer that the agenda be approved. Is there any discussion, any comments or late adds to the agenda? Hearing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed by saying no. The ayes have it unanimously. Now we move to approval of the November 14th regular meeting minutes. They were in your packet, have been circulated, and I will entertain a motion on those minutes.
So moved.
It's moved by Jerika, supported by...
I'll second it.
You do? By Javitt. I will take a minute just to make sure then nobody has any comments or corrections. We can correct the minutes at this point if there's anything that you saw in here that we missed. Our minutes have been very complete, thanks to our secretary and her backup. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed by saying nay. The motion carries with no dissenting votes. We are at the point of public comment. Barbara, you are our public. Do you have comment?
Public has no comment.
No comment from the public. That makes it easier for our secretary. We have a couple of sheets of dates in your packet. So I'll entertain a motion now for approval of the 2018 regular meeting dates for the Belleville Area District Library.
I've checked them all, they're all accurate, so I move that we accept these.
Great. Moved by Jerika.
Second.
Seconded by Stonemeyer. I guess there's no, is the November date the election day?
November 13th,
that's the first.
No, it's Tuesday.
I am.
How are you?
Election day should be the first Tuesday.
No, is Monday? Does things start with Monday?
Let's just look at that before we approve them.
November 6th is election day.
Just like Joyce said, so good for us, since that's an election day for some board members, perhaps. So, okay. I don't have any other questions. Hearing no other comments. All those in favor of approval of the 2018 meeting dates, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed by saying no. The ayes have it unanimously. And now we have the closure dates, the dates that the library will not be operating for business. Noting one of those closure dates is an in-service day, and the others track what we have been doing over our history. Is there a motion to approve the closure date?
The only thing that I always I'm sorry, every library I've worked at, we have closed at on MLK Day, except for the one that I'm not, that I work at now, and the reason is because the schools are closed and we get huge crowds of people for MLK activities. So
you do a lot of activities then?
Yeah, because the kids are out of school anyway, and
The community doesn't do anything?
Well, the community does too. EMU does, has big forums that day, all day forums. But the library still does the stuff.
Well, you have a large African American community.
Yeah.
But MLK Day is not for African Americans, it's for everyone.
I understand.
I know you do.
You're preaching to the choir.
I know you do, Mr. Jurega. And the byline for MLK Day is a day on, not a day off. So if we are not closing for MLK Day, have we traditionally done MLK activities?
Not traditionally, we've done other activities. We've been closed on the state for a while now, so we could certainly redo that.
I'd say that definitely in Brighton we didn't close.
We are closed, I don't want to take the, but there, I do know there are not lots of activities in this area to commemorate Martin Luther King Day. My church has done them, and when they have done them, it's been kind of like the only thing happening in Bedlam. They don't always. So the library would be a good entity to, you know, maybe we have to have something here, but we could partner or try and encourage.
When I worked there, the library was closed, but the high school and the churches and the city had a march, and then they had a big meeting at the high school, a real big meeting, and going over neat programs.
Yeah, we've done all kinds of different things, between having concerts and storytellers and service, you know, doing service activities.
Keeping it this way for this coming year, because
it's less than a
month. Now let's look at it with a new library with more space.
We can look at it.
True, but it
coordinate something with some other organizations too.
This happens a lot, that people start thinking of their next year calendars at the end of the year. Well, Martin Luther King Day comes so early in the year that if you don't already have something going, but we would be an excellent entity to at least partner, if not host, entities for. So it's a good thing for us to focus on. I do too. I think maybe the library could answer that void.
We do have it as a floating holiday, though, so because it is a national holiday, so that causes issues in our organization.
We'll look into that. We'll give us a little more.
I really would like to see. My one last comment is with my good friend John Trigo, who I do understands this holiday as well as anyone. But I do want to see Martin Luther King Day perceived by the entire population as a day for everyone, a day for service for everyone. There's a tendency, I remember a neighbor I had in Lansing the idea that Martin Luther King Day was just for African Americans.
A huge crowd of everyone.
Which is what we should do, and what we as a library should really work to stick to promote that, and I think we're situated to do that than most other entities. All that being said, that's a good issue to be discussed.
I'll make a motion to approve for this year.
Okay.
Yes.
It's been moved by Shehevitz and supported by Hugh Scrubs that we approve the 2018 closure date for the Belleville Area District Library. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed by saying no. The closure dates are approved and the discussion is duly noted. So now we are on to committee reports. And we may have a speedy meeting tonight. Our building committee report will be undertaking our committee reports as a board without our design team represented tonight. So,
well,
Joy,
I left my notes somewhere. I can't find it at the moment quickly before I came here. But Mary Jo's sharing with me her notes. We only
and
had
speak
one.
If you can,
we only, I'm sorry. We only had one meeting, and that was on December 1st, and we received 4 responses to our RFP for the demolition of the HMB property. The proposals ranged from $16,500 to, I believe the highest one was $134,000 and something.
Yeah.
And there was no, based on the review by O'Neill Construction, there was no qualitative difference in those bids, and so we awarded the bid to Blue Ribbon. So that was easy. Apparently the high one didn't really want the job because it was an amazing difference.
Charging us for that's what we had to pay for building.
They should be starting on that.
The 18th of December.
Is that what it was? The weather, has the weather had anything to do with that?
The weather had impact. I blamed the letter that I sent out to local neighbors about the project that said what dates things were going to happen. And I knew as soon as I sent it to village, probably jinxed everything. They were supposed to do the asbestos abatement yesterday and today, and that hasn't happened, most likely because of the weather. In addition to that, I just found out today that the demo can't take place until after Christmas anyway. So we've got to
wait. The deadline was December 31st.
The deadline was December 31st. We're looking at the building demo from December 26th through the 29th. I'm going to call the environmental company about the asbestos remediation.
Has the gas been turned off?
I think they're still working on the utility shut off.
Well, that would be necessary.
Since the tax people in Van Derendel, it's something that they're taxing December 1st, people are starting to question about all this money for the library. And we need to see some action. So I'd like to get some pictures when Blue Ribbon starts knocking them down. Get some pictures in the paper, if we can do that, to show something is going on.
Between Christmas,
probably
and New Year.
Christmas and New Year's.
And you're going to call me?
Yes.
Okay. Because
I'm not going to stand. Because you're not going to stand out here watching. No. The bringing up taxes for this year, hopefully for this year and this year only, because we've just acquired this building and some other things I don't quite understand. We're going to have to pay taxes to Belleville for that building, even
the winter taxes probably.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So we're paying. The library is paying a library mileage. We're paying a library mileage.
On behalf of H&B.
Yeah,
it's ours now. So
yeah. It's ours, yeah. But for whatever reason, which I don't understand.
Well, we will work on getting that. Basically, the assessment is always for the prior year, so there was nothing we could really do about that this year. But we will work on getting the
in future years
reclassified for.
But not just the library mileage.
No,
taxes too.
We're paying the whole taxes, and we're a tax-exempt entity, so that is something. Anyway, we're contributing to Belleville.
Also, Dan was going to have his design and development documents over, should have handed them over to O'Neill already, which means that O'Neill can start narrowing down on pricing as they have, as we get, you know, that process of just continuing to narrow down on our prices. There were some updates to the plan. None of them, I'm trying to see if there's anything, it's a big thing. Friends shelving was increased by to 14 units. There's some nice plans for the youth area portal. We're still pursuing the HVAC screening around the rooftop. We have to go to the zoning board probably. Is there news on that I don't know about?
No.
Okay. And he also presented an updated floor plan for the Sumter site based on actual measurements and field trips there that assigns exact specs to it. So I still have to follow up with Esther with those.
One other thing that Dan brought, actual sample of the bricks that will be used on the exterior of the building. And it seems like December 1st was a whole different season from now, because we all walked out from the meeting outside and stood around mostly without coats that day looking at what the... It was good to see. It's kind of an attractive, unusual kind of brick with a little almost glaze to it, so that as the sunlight hits it in different places, it takes a different look. So we were pleased with that. There was something else that I was thinking. Did you meet with Dan today?
Yes, I did. I met with Dan and representatives from one of the RFID vendors today to really look into some of the specs, especially dealing with how the CERC desk needs to be, how the product works for it. So the radio frequency ID tags itself check out, so people can check out their books. Potentially check out their books themselves with, the company also discussed, even though we don't have this in the budget right now, they're probably going to give us a proposal for the automated materials handling system in case we decide we want to do that in the future. Also looking at the plan just to make sure that everything is positioned the way it needs to be if you want to make that change.
She had a question.
I know this isn't my section of the agenda, but I wanted to ask if the art committee is going to meet with the architect so that we could...
Yeah, the art committee is on the agenda, and we'll talk about that when...
We do have a plan to meet with them in January.
Yeah, we've already got that scheduled.
And I also, was it just last week? Was it the week before? I think it was the week before. I met with Dan and with Angie McAlady from the Library Network. She's the technology director. To discuss our technology plan for the both the main library and the satellite, going into very specific detail with our plans as far as data drops, looking at the server rooms on the first floor and the second floor to make sure they were the right size and shape and dimensions and where things are coming into the building. So Dan's tweaked the second floor server room a little bit, based on that conversation.
Good. So in essence, everything is moving along. We'll have to get further complete updates on some of the continuing interaction with the city, which is, but we are hopefully moving toward finalizing the legal documents. We're waiting. We've both Mary Jo and I have talked to our attorney, and there's a couple of things he's looking at to get that moving. We're still kind of in the same shape with Sumter, where we've given a proposed lease agreement, and we're waiting for the board and their attorney to get with us on that. So we have a lot more details to take care of, but we're moving along, and working very hard with our local, collegial locally elected officials. We're all serving the same constituencies, and I'm hoping we can just keep these things moving, even though the cold is slowing down some things. Is there anything else, any questions that board members, especially board members who are not members of the building committee, have, or our public? Seeing none, then we'll consider that we've done our building committee report.
Shortest one ever.
Yeah, I wonder what the different factor was. Okay, bylaws committee.
I have nothing.
Finance, we do have some items to handle in finance, so I'll turn things over to our treasurer.
So in your packet, you should have the first quarter general fund report. Now, if your copy is like my copy, the first page is page 2 and not page 1, so it looks like it may be out of order. So it should start with the revenues.
Yeah.
Did yours start with the revenues? Okay. Yeah.
Now,
some of them are out of order.
Start with page two.
I only have one. In the middle, the three-month budget is the $483,200, and our actual is the $482,571. So there's a slight shortfall there, but for the most part, you know, we're in line with our budget. The most significant unfavorable amount here is the total fines and fees, which is the $7,766. And it's unfavorable.
That's probably because it's the penal fine revenue, which we only get once a year. So
we see this
every year.
We have the same issue, just because of the fine.
Okay.
And even still, the total
difference is only in the hundreds, not in the thousands.
Because our state aid is up 1,700.
Okay. So,
looking at the expenses, salaries are favorable, and this will be important later. But the budget is $146,000. The actual is $114,976, so we're $31,000 to the good there. On this page, the only item that's unfavorable is under books and acquisitions. That's that $3,498 there. And I know Mary Jo said she's going to keep an eye on that throughout the year.
And I think that might have had something to do with the change in the fiscal year, something that would get pulled out of this budget that needs to be talked about.
These books and acquisitions are at the heart of our mission.
And then if you go to the next page, there really isn't anything here that's significantly unfavorable. There's the $290 under telecommunications, $844 unfavorable under insurance, and then if you look under total printing and publications, there's $663 there that's unfavorable. And on the next page, travel and meetings. That's unfavorable by $546, and that's another thing that Mary Jo and I had talked about, and she'll keep an eye on that throughout the year, but we're not concerned. And then under library program supplies, there's an unfavorable amount of $133.
Now, miscellaneous programming where I had, is that we just didn't do it? We do a lot of programming.
It just depends on the time of year where programs fall. And that's why all some of these numbers are student or whatever.
But we still come out ahead.
Yeah, in the end, we're actually at $55,000 off the board. Then, Mary Jo, I did want to ask you about just the utilities. I noticed that we were favorable there. Is that also another timing?
I try to edge that one a little bit more anyway because I never know if we're going to have a hold of it before it turns out. Or whatever.
So I'm good with this report.
Good. I think we all should be. Well, we have to. This is just information. We don't take action on these updates. And then we also have this other item that was already on here.
The other item is the supplemental information for our general fund. So this shows our original budget, and then we also made our budget amendment in this year, and our actuals, and then our favorable and unfavorable amounts here. So on our revenues, we're actually at $41,000. And then for the expenses, our original budget is the $977,000. The amended is the $991,000. Our actual with expenses is the $943,347. So again, we're favorable.
What was the last word you used?
Favorable.
Oh, favorable, okay.
So 88,000 is in the fund balance?
There's a little under it, yes.
Okay.
And we should have a completed final audit for the next meeting that you can.
Right.
But I just wanted to give you some sense of where we're at with that.
The accountant was still fine. It hasn't totally been signed off by the auditing firm.
Right. So we're still waiting for that.
So we'll get that in the January meeting. So those are two updates that are very important and relevant. That's probably our biggest responsibility, although we've got a lot of things to cover as a board, but stewards of the dollar, being mindful and accountable, being sure we're giving oversight on the budget is most important, and our treasurer has done a fine job on that, our finance committee, with her trusty backup. So does that take care of the finance report, or is there anything else, Tanya? Good. Well, thank you, and I'm glad to see us come out favorable in both of those reports. The marketing committee is next. Is there any report? No report on that one. The personnel committee has a bit to report to us about today, so our secretary will have to take the lead here in talking.
So we have two things to discuss under the personnel committee. The first being our library director's evaluation. And with this being a personnel issue, she has the right to choose to do this in a closed session or not. So we defer to you. Okay. I didn't think she would, but I had to offer. So, Mary, the personnel committee, along with the assistance of the entire board, thank you everybody for turning in your evaluation forms, did an evaluation for Mary Jo. Mary Jo was evaluated in four areas: applied library knowledge, relationship development, leadership management, and marketing and program development. She was evaluated on a scale of 1 to 6, with 1 being unsatisfactory and 6 being outstanding. Mary Jo obtained a score of above average, which is a 5, to outstanding, which is a 6.
Do we have a copy of this?
In all categories. We don't have a
copy. Oh, okay.
In all categories. She has met more than one of her major goals, which is in your packet, and she kind of really laid it out for you.
Oh,
our major goals are
goals,
here.
Sorry.
Yeah, her goals are in here. So she had quite a few goals, and she's met lots of them. You can certainly take a look at it in your leisure time. And I'll let her explain a little bit more how she laid it out, because there's some green and there's some orange to indicate. I believe green indicates goals that were met, and orange indicates things that are still in process. And so after the personnel committee came together, tallied up everything, we had a discussion with Mary Jo as to a recommended increase. And at this time, we are recommending that she be given a salary increase of 2.5%. And so that's something that we as a board have to vote.
What percentage was that again?
2.5% salary increase.
I attended the personnel committee, or at least part of it, and I know that the personnel committee did take the form that we all filled out, the evaluation form, and tallied up the average scores for each of the areas that we evaluated. So that was to John's question. That could be reviewed by board members if they wished. Okay.
Yeah, we actually prepared like a summary that shows all of the averages for the scores, and then all of the comments too are also on that same summary sheet, so that it's still anonymous, but all of the comments are good, so the individual would have that, so we do have that.
Okay, I knew that you had worked on that, and so I do want to make board members aware that was done for Mary Jo to be able to see what board members had to say and where their evaluation was, but it's also available for other board members to look at. It is personnel, so it's a private item. I would repeat Michelle's opening statement that all the averages came out between the, what's the top of
outstanding.
Outstanding, between outstanding and above average. Everything was somewhere in those areas. Meaning that I think there's a unanimous, very supportive point of view about the job that our director is performing.
When we make a motion to give her a 2.5% increase?
Right now.
Madam Chair,
we give
Mary Jo a 2.5% increase in pay, and or she can't refuse it this year as she did last year. Or if she does refuse it, we give her more days off.
Looks like you have to. Boy, what a problem
she can't
to have.
Days off. There's too many things to do.
Right. She already is in here after hours and working 24/7, so any day off she takes, she ends up working it anyway. There is a motion for and a second, seconded by our treasurer. That's significantly indicating we can afford to make this motion and pass it for the approval of the personnel committee's recommended raise for our director. Any further discussion?
I just want to say to John, thank you for making the motion. Also, just a point of clarity to your motion. You said if she can't refuse it. I had that discussion with the personnel committee had that discussion with her in advance, like, look. So
that's not a good example.
You have to depress his dwelling.
Well, I commend Mary Jo. We've done really good for this library and through this process.
Yeah, especially this process going on now.
A lot of balls to juggle and keep in the air at once.
Such a heavy lift during the new library development. And I don't think, I mean, it's every day. There's something every day. But in addition to keeping this library going, keeping our programming and our staff and, you know, supervising and doing all the things that have to be done, the new library project is something that takes work. And it takes work from me as chair and from the building committee in particularly, but from our director in a way that, you know, really, because we wouldn't be able to do what we do if Mary Jo wasn't full-time keeping up with all those details. So it's a special time and a time, and this raise is truly deserved and certainly not out of line in its amount. So anybody else want to say something? I know Tanya and LaShelle worked through and had a direct meeting or a phone meeting with Mary Jo and talked to her about their findings. And so I think that we as a board have done our responsibility there too, which
we're
to
our
oversight.
The format too.
Right. Yeah.
It's easier to follow.
Our updated, yeah, it is. So, with that, there is a motion and a second. Moved by Jurega and seconded by Studemeyer. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, signify by saying no. That motion carries with no dissenting votes. Do you? I could have called a roll call.
Could I ask what her salary is before this?
Yeah, I think you get it every year and tell us all, but
remind
me. Tell you right now.
Yeah. So I don't have to.
I'm not the right.
So you don't have to look in your own notes.
Well, I do, but I want to be sure.
We have several people consulting their phones to answer you, Rosemary, so it's not just one.
$77,251.
$77,251.
Thank you.
Uh-huh.
It's still below teacher salary.
Well, it's below a lot of salaries.
It's at the low end of the range, because the range is 76 to 85, so she's at 77,251.
Which is why she needs to take her raise.
Is it a range based on the libraries with this budget?
It's based on libraries from the Detroit Suburban Library Roundtable that serve a similar population to us.
What's
our population? 42,361. From the last census, it's probably higher.
Good. Well, if it is higher, that would be good, huh?
I guess my library is mixed up which one is.
You have a lot to keep up. So, good. We've done that. We have another item under personnel.
Yeah. So, So the second item under personnel in your packet is the technology manager job description.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a chance to meet with Mary Jo and get an understanding as to why she needs this position added to the staff. Initially, we're thinking that this person would start in January. And at some point, once we have our satellite branch, they would also be our main purpose of supervising that location.
So we, when Angie McLeaney was up in the library and worked, we also consulted with her on this job description to make sure we were hitting all of the points.
I'm glad to see a higher pay range.
and again, we went to the Defensive Room Library Roundtable stats. For this one, we went a little bit broader. We looked at the past 4, 5, and 6, but we only looked at the libraries that are part of our shared library system.
Yeah, this is significantly more than the budget we looked has to know how good enough for good qualified people. The last issue, physical ability to.
And this is the overall range. I'm looking at targeting the lower end of their range. Can we get a little bit of that?
Is January realistic?
No. We will post it and start the review in January, probably helping hire someone to start in January.
Okay. Okay, and this needs approval?
Yes.
Okay.
Make a motion to approve the addition of a technology manager?
Sure.
I second it.
It's been moved by Chahevitz and supported by Studemeyer that the technology manager dot job be approved to be posted and filled.
Will this individual be,
Yeah.
Will this individual be not judged, what do I want to say, every year?
Evaluated.
Evaluated, thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Who will do that, you?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? It's certainly appropriate in that libraries more and more are technology sources and being up top on technology is, and we're what we're going through in our physical change. So this is it.
Well, so many things talk to each other these days with different systems, and it's not just the viewing system, the phone system, or the security system.
Right. And it certainly answers the question, those that silly question about obsolescence of libraries. They are not obsolete, they are just more technologically sophisticated than ever before. So, with all of that, our motion is on the table, and is there anybody else? All those in.
Oh, sorry, I just wanted to say one of the things, too, that really, really sold me on having a technology manager is that there is a lot of technology going into the new building, and this will, the technology manager will be in charge of, or the point person on dealing with the architects and everybody else, so that takes something off of Mary Jo's plate. Yes, so certainly a position that's needed.
That's a very good point, and the personnel committee has gotten their work. They've gotten their time.
The firewalls be the team for TLM?
Yes.
Okay, I didn't see that.
And that was one thing I talked about with Andy. She said, we really don't do that in the top level, so you don't know.
I just wanted to add, you know, from our first quarter report, we know that we're, you know, 31,000 to the bridge is a quarter.
So,
so
we can handle this. And we're going to be staffing up for the new library. It's good that we start, and this is a great place to start, which is, again, a credit to our director's visionary approach to what we're doing here.
And I also want them to have experience in our current building to see what we're doing here, so they know they have that history, too.
Good.
And then another good thing was, under the qualifications, we're saying a bachelor's degree or a minimum of 2 years' work experience. So we're not requiring a degree necessarily.
Mm-hmm. Some in the tech industry some of the top people have more hands-on experience. Yeah.
Like your kids, your high school kids.
Outdo you without a bachelor's degree. So is there readiness for the vote?
Yes.
Okay. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed by saying no. The technology manager position is approved. And is that the, does anyone have a
personnel report?
Includes personnel. The policy, although our policy committee chair is not here, MJ Dawson is not here, she did her work, and her committee member is here, and that's Alma Hughes Brooks, and I also attended meetings. This might be of interest, particularly in our public, to Barbara. We'll be talking in the policy committee about some changes to the policies that we just approved at our last meeting, and then we will have a separate discussion of an art committee update, which is not exactly, the committee is still forming under these policies, but we'll all discuss that. And I'll have an announcement at the beginning of that. But right now, under policy committee, I can just give background, then I'm going to hand this over to Alma. We did, as I just said, approve these policies at the last meeting. And we had a discussion. We discussed at the last meeting that the art committee was to be meeting that next night, I believe, and did. And I remember in our discussion, I remember John bringing up that there might be some points in that came out of that discussion in the art committee that might be relevant. We decided, however, that we needed, that we wanted to have it in place so that the art committee could meet and know that the board had moved to create the committee and create a structure for it. But in the discussion at the art committee, there were some, from we've had a good inclusion so far for a committee that has yet to be specifically formed, and a couple of the items discussed were the entire policy committee was there because Alma and Mary Jane were both there, and Mary Jane made some suggestions which she has included and highlighted in yellow of suggested amendments based on that discussion. And I might defer to Alma to just go over it. There's one item on the temporary exhibits display policy, and then the permanent has a couple of areas. So, Alma, take it from there.
It's just language changes, it sounds like.
Yeah. And Doug Peters was very instrumental. I appreciate his efforts at making a couple of these changes. He suggested some language. The first on both policies is to discuss this as a request for reconsideration. A piece of art rather than using the heading of intellectual freedom.
Which is the same as
the. And it's the same as. And it's the same language, isn't it? Right, yeah. So that makes sense. And then I can't remember the exact discussion on page 2 of the permanent art policy.
It has to do with insurance, right?
Yeah, and we don't want to lock ourselves in that having to provide insurance that we don't want to. We have the option of doing that.
Now, Doug Peters is the perfect person to have on this, with his legal background and his art background.
He was very helpful. Yeah. And the deaccession issues were, to avoid future complications. And they were things that people that don't function in that arena all the time might not be aware of. And he gave us some great input. So the items and guidelines for deassessing artwork were also recommendations from him. And then there was a change in language on the request for reconsideration, which is, as you said, is consistent with what's on the other policy. As far as policies, we would accept a motion to make the changes that are indicated by highlight on the two policies that were included in your packets.
Madam Chair, I make a motion we accept the temporary art exhibits and display policy and the permanent art acquisition and art display policy.
As amended.
As amended.
Is there support for the motion?
Second.
Okay, it's been moved by Jerega and seconded by Shahevitz that the amendments to the two policies, the temporary art exhibits and display policy and the permanent art acquisition and art display policy be adopted.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
After the board has discussed, I'd like to just make a comment.
Do you want to, after we vote, or do you want to make your comment before we vote?
Before you vote.
Okay.
All right.
The comment might be the time.
Because I was at the meeting that Doug spoke.
There was a second meeting that you were not in attendance with this one.
And did Doug attend that meeting as well?
Yes, he did.
Yeah.
Okay, because this final draft, I wondered if he had looked at it.
Yes.
Okay. And he approved it and he had no other comments?
That is, as far as, I believe so. I know he looked at all of these as we talked.
The reason I asked that is because he was so knowledgeable. I mean, it was just amazing. And we all were all educated listening to him.
Yeah.
And I consider myself fairly knowledgeable, but I was really enlightened by what he had to say. So
we agree. This is really a rich community, and it's wonderful for our library to be able to take advantage of some of the talent in the community.
Thank you.
We agree completely. With both the meetings, the one that you attended and this other one that you made these recommendations. So there is a motion on the floor with a move and a second. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed by saying no. Hearing none, the items have been amended. We are, and this moves us smoothly into the art committee update, which I will give. First, I do have an announcement. The other art policy that we approved last week, which is not amended today, gave the basic structure of the art committee, who would be in it, and we are moving, and that's why we wanted to get it in place, so that we could start moving. And you will remember that there is, in that policy, there is the provision for a member to be represented from the Friends of the Library, and that member was chosen at an earlier Friends meeting, and that is Donna Lavin. Donna, there's another name. Gilkey Lavin, who has been attending these meetings. And then we've had several members, and I think we've talked often about the partnership with BACA that we are engaging in with the Arts Committee, and BACA talked about several people who have interest, and we are eager to have them all engaged, but we asked BACA to also provide one voting member, and that has now happened. I have been notified by the chair of BACA, and that's Mindy Russell, that Barbara Miller is selected as the voting member from BACA, which also means that we do encourage the other BACA members to participate, and we encourage you, Barbara, to, you know, work with them for
Is that feeling in the Art Council that their opinions are welcome.
Good.
Their participation is appreciated.
Therefore, the committee has moved forward in that regard, because that's one more step in formalizing that committee. The other item I wanted to report is that from our board, Mary Jane, Alma, and I, as board members, attended, and Mary Jo attended the second meeting. And it was decided at that time that the art committee would not meet until the first of the year, in January, and we picked a date, which is, I'm hoping somebody here can tell me,
January 17th.
That sounds like the date we picked to me.
At 7 p.m.?
At 7 p.m. And at that meeting, this is relevant to Barbara's question earlier. That is a meeting that we are have invited our architect to attend so that we can talk in a more specific way. The architect, Dan, has talked to the building committee in some ways about how best to plan for art and what he might have to do and how we should proceed. And appropriately, the building committee, I mean, the art committee also wants to be able to meet directly with Dan. So that has been arranged and that will take place. And the further we go with shaping up our policies and finalizing the steps in selection, the better off we are. We as a board, I guess we can finalize the total appointments for that committee in the January meeting. That'll take place before the art committee. We have them pretty much all filled up. Well, that's the other item I wanted to talk to all of you about is that we have two members on that committee according to the policy. And at this point, the indications I've gotten were there was interest from Mary Jane Dawson and from Alma Hughes Grubbs to participate on that. So that, just like I was announcing that, Barbara, pardon?
Not John.
John has attended and can attend. I want John to come back in the room. He's on his way back in. John, we're talking about you.
Yes, here.
So we need you for us to talk about you, okay. Because it's always so much more fun when we're talking about you and you're around.
What's happening?
I was just announcing that BACA had made their formal selections for who the voting members of the art committee are. Uh-huh. And we as a board are to select according to that policy we approved last time. We as a board are to select the two board members who've indicated interest in serving formally on that committee that I know of are Mary Jane Dawson and Alma Hughes Grubbs. And I was wondering if you were not interested.
I do have a degree, a minor in art and design. So, yes.
I understand that as an interest. Again, like the BACA members, it is a question, and we don't have to resolve it tonight. It's a question of who the voting members are going to be. So we as a board, or me, it would really be the chair appoints. And if we have three members that are interested, I can wait and make the formal appointment in January, and we can all talk it over and decide how we want to go. Is that okay with you, Alma? You're the other one that's here that was interested.
Yes.
Okay. Again, John has attended, I think, both of those meetings. And just as I said about BACA, the members that are interested and that have been attending, I would hope that all three of these members on this board who are interested in that art committee will attend it, regardless of which two are selected as the voting members. The more informed we are and the more crossover there is and those people that are interested in the arts. And we also see the art effort, the engagement of the community in how we express the arts in our new building. We see that as a part of our engagement, which is one of the reasons Alma indicated an interest, because it kind of dovetails with marketing and engaging the population. So it's a good thing when we have enough interest, and we have, in this case, we have enough interest. So we'll formalize the appointments from this body, and then this body appoints two artists. And so far, we believe one of those artists for sure will be
John Doug Peters, I never remember which one comes first.
John Doug Peters.
So our committee is moving forward in its terms of its formal membership and its formal structure, and also in terms of its function it's already begun. So we will include it, and at some point we will have an art committee chair. That art committee chair may or may not be a member of this board, but we will be sure that we will continue to have art committee updates on our board agendas. So I think, given that Alma and John are board members who were at that committee, is there something else we should talk about at this point that you're thinking of, you, Alma? Okie dokie. Then we'll consider that concludes the art committee update. So we now move on to item 9, approval of accounts payable.
Make a motion to approve accounts payable.
And is there support from our treasurer for approving accounts payable? Support. It's been moved by Chehevitz, supported by Strudemeyer, that the accounts payable be approved. It is important that we all, this is again stewards of the public dollar, it's important that we all look over these, and often there are questions or points raised by board members about the items we're approving. So are there any such questions? Well, this is a happy group today. We're all in the holiday spirit. Hearing none, we have a motion on the table, a motion that is duly seconded. All those in favor of approving the accounts payable, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed by saying no. Passes unanimously. And we are to the formal director's report. We've already evaluated her, now it's time for her to report.
As LaShawn mentioned, that you have my list of goals from last year, and it was very much a roadmap that kind of changed a little bit throughout the year, so I kind of added to it some notes about what kind of happened during the year. As she said, the green are things that you know, were pretty much accomplished. Orange signifies something that is still in progress, or the target changed.
On your goals for last year, was hoopla an actual goal for last year?
To look at, we are still researching that. We tend to get cold feet on that because they can be potentially a real budget breaker. Because
it's based on use.
It's based on, how many people checked out. So we have to set a budget, and basically we probably have to limit and say, okay, you can check out two. And the e-books, e-audio, the videos that you can check out
and
online.
And Hoopla is a library.
It's a digital format, so that it just like OverDrive, it gives you books, e-books, audiobooks, and movies. It also gives you music. Mm-hmm. Unlike OverDrive, everything that's available there is available to every, if a classroom of kids were going to read the same book, they could read. They could all check it out at the same time at Hoopla. But it's a pay-for-use model, so that if the whole classroom checks out the same book, then that whole classroom is 30 people, 30 checkouts are being charged to the library. So it's like you want it to be used, but if it's used heavily, then
you need to throttle it back and say, okay, you can only check out 2 items per month.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So in our in our library, it was 6 originally. Mm-hmm. Now it's gone up to 8. Mm-hmm. But now we're selling it to the schools, and we either increase if the schools pick it up like they want, like a couple of the
cost.
We could have to limit it or put more money in that direction. So, but it's a nice...
that's the other point to this is that there's a whole special library talk. Because hoopla to the rest of us would mean we were going to make a big to-do over something. But hoopla to you guys.
That's cool.
All righty.
So it is really cool. So even as I said, we're still on the fence on that one. And then at the end, I have my goals for the coming year. Both years, you can see how a lot of these goals dovetail into the, you know, moving towards the new library. Mm-hmm. One way or another.
And a whole bunch of additional ones that didn't even weren't even thought of.
Right. I've got a question.
Okay.
On the second page on the facilities, the fourth item down with the orange one, when you're dealing with materials existing at the library before we destroy this building, you've got retention of it or destruction of this stuff. I know construction companies would just like to smash everything down and take the dump, and they separate stuff there. My thing is, I'd like to recycle as much as this if we possibly can. Yes, there may be a problem with liability, but we got all new windows in the entire building, and they can be reused. The bookshelves can be reused by schools or churches or stuff like this, and we can just, you know, reuse this stuff.
I think we need to talk with our construction manager.
That's going to be the hard part. Yeah. They don't like that.
Well, we'll do that in the conversation. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Because I
they'd rather just knock it down.
I agree. It'd be great to refinish whatever we can.
And some of it, maybe we can, the libraries who are going through renovations and stuff do library garage sales where they'll post a bunch
those,
of stuff.
Those beans
things
out there
that are nice.
Gorgeous.
Oh, they don't do the beams. It's usually furniture.
Yeah, I
understand. We've already had patrons upset. What are you doing with those windows? What are you doing with those lights?
But again, it's liability, too.
Right.
That's the
thing our construction managers and all talk about is liability issues that we might incur doing that. So we have been in, to John's point, he's been raising these issues in the building committee as appropriately at when it's appropriate, and so I think we're moving ahead mindful of those things. I just don't know how it will come out, and we've been talking about those beams out there, and you know, of course we came up with various theories, but hopefully something will come rather than just chucking them up and sending them off to a landfill.
Yeah.
We have sent our newsletter to the printer, and in the process of doing that, we need to do a little bit of planning ahead. And we looked at the schedule. National Library Week is in the middle of May, and so we thought
in the middle of April,
and so I thought there would be a good time to have a ceremonial groundbreaking during National Library Week. So we're tentatively planning that for Saturday, April 14th.
What's the date?
April 14th, it's a Saturday. And
what time did we say?
We haven't set the time yet, although I would like to see maybe some kind of brunch, which would be nice, along with the groundbreaking.
So you're thinking late morning, perhaps?
Yeah, probably maybe 11.
Can we invite Debbie Dingle?
Sure.
Because she helped us with the
telephone. Yeah, we would want to be inviting all kinds of public officials, everybody, but Debbie has been in.
Yeah.
Whenever I see her, that's what I talk to her about. So she's staying aware that our plan is underway. So we'll start talking to her about the 14th real quick.
I want to just mention on the director's report, I think there's a mistake in the adult and children's programming because those numbers are exactly the same.
Oh, okay. I will check on that. Yeah, that's not right.
Unlikely.
Highly unlikely. I will make sure that that gets fixed for next month.
Yeah. And usually the youth will be much higher.
It's going to be interesting. It's going to be interesting comparing this year's statistics to the new library statistics.
Well, but in between, we have next year and the year after, which are building years, which we'll have to see whether or not it affects our...
They're probably will.
Yeah.
Yeah, I talked with Dan a little bit today about the logistics of the entry and things that we might have to do to revamp the wheelchair accessibility temporarily, once they start working on the...
How often do we get wheelchairs in?
We have just one tonight, Judy's daughter.
I know, I see them occasionally, and I know, you know, we...
And it's not just wheelchairs.
It's strollers, yeah, it's a lot of things. We have people bringing something heavy in and have it on a rolling or rolling bags they're carrying or whatever. So it's very useful, but I was just wondering.
I'm talking about freezing cold.
It's always cold.
On that note, I have one more point. I just wanted to alert you to the issues that are going on right now with net neutrality. The American Library Spring Association is very much in favor of net neutrality, as am I. So I give you a little bit of information about what that is, why it matters.
It's a huge deal. And check your emails, because you have emails that have been sent over.
And there are ways that you can weigh in on the FCC page if you wanted to leave a comment.
I think that is crazy.
Yeah, well, they are crazy. I mean,
A huge impact on people's access to information.
That's right.
You know, they decide to throttle something back or charge them, you know, a huge extra fee for certain websites over others.
Thank you. And then there's digital.
Yeah.
I love how favorite digital is over the two, including that. I thought that was interesting.
Yeah. Have a lovely relationship sometimes.
Yeah. Are there any further questions to our director on the report or anything else? And this has been a big day. We're moving along still, but the issue of the evaluation and the goals and the planfulness of how we hold it. Again, the visionary action of our director is really important.
Our staff has been very, very instrumental in helping everything. So.
They are also trying to help you not to overload. So we'll keep working on that too. So we are at the point of our agenda for trustee comments. And today, we'll start over with Alma.
Just wanted to say, you know, hope everybody has a safe holiday, because I don't think there will be me as a group before the first of the year. And building committee, outstanding job as usual.
We're not doing anything.
We've been resting on our laurels.
We had a meeting.
You had a clock in his hours. 183, you told me last time.
What's that?
Hours.
For the building.
Only 87.
No.
The building committee.
183 is what you showed
me
last time.
In my diary? I don't think it was that high.
Oh, all right. Maybe I'm wrong.
I think I got 87. Which is still...
You just added 100.
100, yeah.
Any other comment? Are you commenting, Joy? Is that your comment?
Oh, no. I want to thank the art committee for a job well done and the collaboration with Baca and with the Friends to make this a community endeavor. I also want to once again commend Mary Jo. I think she's done a really fabulous job. And a time where she's had to learn a lot of things on the fly, like bonds, and how they're set up and made, blah, 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 blah. So Good job this year.
Thank you. Michelle?
You can type while you talk.
I know. Think she's gonna take you up on that?
I will, Joy knows that. I just want to say thanks once again for everyone who completed their evaluation form. And a huge thanks to Taya for putting the summary together of all the evaluation forms. I want to commend the art committee on getting everything together. And to my friend, Barb, congratulations on being the voting member. I'm excited about those who have been selected to be on the committee, and I look for great things to happen with that art committee. And just Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays to everyone. I'm looking forward to great things to come in 2018.
Thank you. I just want to thank Mary Jo again. You know, since we had a chance to do her evaluation and sit down with her and talk about all the things that she's doing. And, you know, I think she's doing a really great job. I'm very impressed with her. You know, we've kind of laid a lot on her, and I really think she is handling it well. So I just want to thank you.
John. Mary Jo introduced me to Santa last night. And, of course, I had to put him on Facebook.
And when he did, people said he looks like Santa's brother.
I only see him once a year, so it's, you know, it was special. Also, Sharon, myself, and Mary Jo attended the parade. It was very cold, I thought, and we walked. It was enjoyable. That's it. And thank you again, Mary Jo, for an outstanding job.
Well, thank you, trustees. And for chair comments, I'm taking up where John left off. The Winterfest parade and the library's participation in it was a whole lot of fun. Our two young staffers, Jackie and her sister
Noelle,
which how can I forget Noelle in this season? How can I forget her name? Noelle and Jackie did the cutest job for our little float we had, and you can't believe it, but the day before and the day of, it was all sunny outside and warm, and they were out here putting together that float and putting a tree with books and lights, and it all lit up and looked good, and I walked along with Jackie pulling it, and every once in a while I got it tangled in my foot because I'm a klutz, but it was a lot of fun. And it was a good chance to talk to them, especially Jackie was walking. You didn't get to walk with us in a while. But you did a great job on putting that together for us. And we had a whole lot of fun. Debbie Green joined us that night as well. It was a good chance for the staff, board, and former staff, as it turns out, to represent the library well. And it was a good chance for the community. It was before the deep freeze and all the snow fit in, but as John said, it was warm in the day that day, but at night it got cold. Ricky and your grandkids came and walked with us as well. So board member Chehevitz was represented as well. So that was great fun. That and the cookie, the gingerbread cookies and all that we do for Christmas, as well as Santa Claus last night, are big parts of how the library really is part of the holiday season in Belleville, and a real hub for community activity. And the other thing I want to bring attention to is where I've taken a new place to park every day. I park in front of the sign for the new new library. And I think Lachelle said it to me the other day, the sign really pops. It really attracts attention, that sign. I'm hoping, and I'd really be interested with our public tonight. We have two very good representatives of the public between Rosemary and Barbara. They probably have their ears to the ground better than most people. And we'll be wondering whether or not the sign is anything, or people are taking notice of it. What we want to accomplish with that is to get people interested in the new library that don't always come in. Because those who come in see all our stuff, but some people in town may not be familiar, and they might have seen when we were But the library looks quite a bit different from what the rough outlines were when we were on the bond. So we'll be looking, and we want that sign to invite discussion with a community-wide discussion about the new library and engage the community. So the art committee, I too thank you, Barbara, for participating formally on the art committee. The art committee is a way to engage the community every way that we can. We want to do that and engage our fellow public officials in that. And we officially wish the community a very, very Merry Christmas.
Madam Chair, I make the motion, meeting adjourned.
And is there support?
Second.
Second by Spoonmeyer. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? I think that's a unanimous, and I let the record show it is 5 minutes to 9 o'clock. So I still have time to go retrieve.